sit down, back of a bus, round and round. Call us welfare moms pushing crack cocaine, jump Jim Crow and we're back again.
Say your name.
Say their names.
And let them know. So welcome, everyone. It's so good to see all of you. On behalf of GLIDE and the White Anti-Racist Group, we really welcome you to tonight's open session of our work. And for those of you who maybe aren't familiar, the GLIDE's Anti-Racist Group began after the murder of George Floyd, and we've been coming together as a GLIDE community and beyond to really do, to put the time in and do the work that we as white folks need to do around this really painful reality that is so prevalent in our worlds. So we're really honored today to have a special guest, Taun Hall, and she will be talking about her son, Miles Hall, and we have another guest, Tara, who will be talking about an assembly bill that is before the Senate, AB 988, the Miles Hall Lifeline and Suicide Prevention Act. So got a really, I think, a great evening in store for you. I sent you a text, but Marvin, would you like to say any words? Marvin is our Minister of Celebration at GLIDE. I want to give you a chance in case you'd like to.
I'm in. I finally made it in. I've been wanting to say that. Hi, Taun. Hey, Tara. It is nice to meet y'all. We're so glad that you are in conversation with this amazing group of folks who are putting in the work, who are participating in a long and historic tradition of social justice work that gives a way for everybody who didn't know they had a social justice arm or call to seasoned social justice warriors. This group has allowed folks to find the work that they're supposed to be doing at a pace and a way that's comfortable and authentic to their voice and their lives. And it's an amazing group of folks that are gathered here today. I just want to say thank you and welcome on behalf of GLIDE Memorial Church. You know, as a social justice church, I'm not going to start preaching. But, you know, the God of my understanding also lost a child to state violence. And so understands the call on your life right now, you know, and we pray to that God and believe in that one who is all about the justice. So you are in good hands with this group of folks, and I look forward to hearing your story tonight. So thank you for being here.
Thank you, Marvin. Appreciate that. And also, I just want to mention that I'm part of the steering committee for the WAG group, and I want to acknowledge my partners, Pam Nolley, who really derives the curriculum for our work. So deep bow to you, Pam. Thank you. Winnie Fink, Tom Butler, and Linda Mantel are the other members of our steering committee. So I welcome you on their behalf as well. So since we do have a couple people with us for the first time today, I just want to go over really briefly our group agreements. One of the things we recognize is to hold this kind of space, we need to come to some general understanding about how we want to, the values that we want to imbue into our conversation. So the first one is to stay engaged at the level of participation that is right for you. So we learn by speaking and by listening, which is another value that we have, is to speak your truth, but also to really deeply listen with that curiosity. And that these conversations are sometimes uncomfortable, and our goal is not to be comfortable, but to, as best we can, to remain curious and to practice open-heartedness as we engage in these conversations. And we also expect that we're not going to solve this. tonight. That as much as our hearts wish that this could be figured out and solved, our work is just to keep on keeping on. And so we do this with great humility, but also picking up what is ours to carry. So those are our just general kind of group agreements. And our flow for the evening is after I'm going to do a short little grounding exercise. One of the things that we have discovered in this work is that it's really helpful to come into your bodies and to really do that with a sense of compassion, both for ourselves and for others. So I'm going to give you a little flavor of what those are like, and you're invited to participate in that. And then we're going to be hearing from Tara, who is the person who really has been moving the legislation through the, she and her allies, I assume, and so pushing the legislation through the Senate, through the California Senate. So we're going to have a chance for her to speak. And then we're going to hear from Taun Hall, mother of Miles, and there'll be a chance for some Q&A. And then we'll end with a final closing. So if you would like to find a posture for yourself in this moment that feels comfortable for you, and this is really an invitation to investigate how you might hold your body in this moment that creates both a sense of ease and alertness. So sometimes that takes a little wiggling in your chair to find what's just right for you. And the invitation is to direct our gaze inward. And so you can either do that by closing your eyes or just having a soft gaze. You also are completely in choice if you want to have your camera off. And as we arrive, I'm going to invite you to begin by noticing your breath. You are a body that is breathing. And specifically noticing the sensations of breath. Notice what it feels like in your body to breathe in, and what it's like to exhale, to breathe out. Feeling perhaps the nourishment and energy that comes with your in-breath, the way something releases with your out-breath. Perhaps noticing this rhythm of inhale and exhale, almost like the waves of an ocean, flowing in and flowing out. Using our bodies to land in this moment that we're in right now. Not yesterday's breath or tomorrow's breath, but this one right here. And as we perhaps begin to slow down, perhaps find some measure of stillness, you might notice some arrivals, whether they be thoughts or feelings or body sensations. Perhaps there's something pleasant, excitement or interest, or maybe you feel really good, hopeful. Or perhaps there's something challenging here, a sadness or anger. Perhaps somewhere your body feels uncomfortable or is in pain. So if you notice any kind of challenge that happens to be present in your moment right now, I invite you to direct your in-breath, your inhale to yourself. So breathing in, feeling yourself expand with your inhale, breathing in this nourishment. I invite you to do something extra with that breath. And that is to infuse it with this capacity to care from within your own heart, attaching to your inhale your own ability to care for this one right here. So breathing in some kindness and compassion for this one here, this you. Letting it feel your body. Let it be something that can hold whatever is present for you in this moment. Then I invite you, if you would like, you can either just stay here breathing in compassion for yourself, or if your heart feels like it has capacity, I invite you to now direct your attention to your exhale and to notice when you bring attention to your exhale how something releases, something goes into the world. And so again, using this muscle of your heart, I invite you to attach to your exhale compassion for others. Perhaps there's someone that comes to mind, someone that you know who is struggling or hurting. Letting your exhale be a sending of something good. May you be free from suffering, or may you be well, may you be safe. Perhaps tonight you might even want to send, if you have capacity, send some compassion to Taun and her family, to all mothers who've lost children. Perhaps sending compassion to Black and brown bodies that continue in our culture to bear so much pain and violence. Compassion for all those who are trying to make a difference. And then, once again, returning to your inhale, breathing in compassion for you. And then exhale, breathing out compassion to someone who needs it. Perhaps even using this mantra, compassion in for me with your inhale, compassion out for you with your exhale. In for me, out for you. Feeling the way you are part of this endless circle of compassion. A circle that is big enough to include all of us, including ourselves. In the words of Martin Luther King, we are caught up in an inescapable network of mutuality, tied in a single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly. And then the man that Martin Luther King nominated for a Nobel Prize in 1967, Thich Nhat Hanh, who we just lost last week, some words from him. We are here to awaken from the illusion of our separateness. Compassion in for me, compassion out for you. Then I invite you to let go of this reflection, this meditation, and take just a moment to sit in your experience, allowing yourself to be just as you are, just like this. And then when you are ready, coming back to our Zoom group. And for a moment, perhaps if you want to turn your cameras on, for those who wish to be on camera, and this is completely optional, perhaps just taking a moment to gaze around the room, to take in the people that are here, maybe sending them some compassion, but not forgetting yourself. All these good souls that have taken the time to do this work together. So deep gratitude to all of you. I think I forgot to mention, and it's a little late in the game, but we are recording this session. So you probably got that prompt when you joined. normally we don't record our WEG sessions, but since there are a number of people who really wanted to be here who couldn't, we decided to do a recording for this session. So before I introduce our speakers, I want to check with the team. Did I forget anything? No. Okay.
Thank great. One
small thing.
Yes.
If anyone is not on the White Antiracist Group mailing list and would like to be, I will put my email address in the chat, and you can just private message me and let me know, and I'll make sure you get on there.
Thank you, Winnie. That was in my notes and I forgot. So thank you for catching that. Yes, we'd love to have you join us. And as I mentioned, we do have two really exciting guests with us tonight. And we're first going to hear from Tara, who is going to talk a little bit about this Senate bill. And maybe, Tara, if you want to just I know you're with the Steinberg Institute, but maybe if you want to just give a little blurb on where you on you, that would be great too.
Absolutely. Well, first of all, thank you so much for having me. And I have to say, we've been doing some work at the Steinberg Institute just in our internal work in terms of, you know, really showing up for one another. And the first thing that we instituted was settling in at the beginning of every meeting. And so I, one, had not gotten my meditation in for the day, and also, two, really appreciate the practice. So it's a great way to begin this meeting. I'm Tara Gamboa Eastman. I'm the legislative advocate with the Steinberg Institute, which means my life revolves around bills and budget, regulatory and administrative advocacy. But I'm from San Francisco and I'm super aware of GLIDE and am just in awe of all the work you do. I'm the daughter of a career social worker who worked in the mission with the severely mentally ill. And that really was what propelled me into public policy. And it was such a joy to land at the Steinberg Institute and get to focus on mental health, because it was my little origin story. And so I moved up here a couple of years ago and worked for Assemblymember Ting from San Francisco, and made this transition over last year to the Steinberg Institute, where I got to start this wonderful work on 988. Just before I jump into the work, a little bit about the Steinberg Institute. We were founded in 2015 by the now mayor of Sacramento, Daryl Steinberg, when he was leaving the Senate. He was previously the president of the Senate and was a real champion for mental health. And when he left, there was really no one to take up the mantle. And so he started this institute with two goals in mind. One, to advance sound public policy on mental health. But the second was to inspire leadership on the issue. And so that is an equal part of our mission. And so working with outside groups, working with the legislature to really facilitate that leadership as however we can, we're really inspired by. I think that's it about the Institute. One other thing to note, I know you mentioned that we won't solve this work, you know, overnight, and that it's going to be uncomfortable. part of the thing that's so uncomfortable about this bill is that the politics get in the way. And one of the really unique things about the Steinberg Institute is we will in no way ever benefit from the bills or the budget items that we advance. We don't have a constituency, we're not a membership organization. And so we have the freedom to fight alongside folks like Taun just because we believe in the policy, which is an absolute luxury and we're so grateful to have it. So what we're all here about, AB 988, Assembly Bill 988, the Miles Hall Lifeline Act, is inspired and the direct result of federal legislation to take the National Suicide Prevention Lifeline, the existing 10-digit number, and replace it with 988 with a new expanded vision to create an alternative to 911 nationwide for mental health. And the vision is really threefold. Someone to call, someone to come, and somewhere to go. Everyone should be able to access counseling when they need it. So that's the first piece, trained mental health professionals on the other phone to talk to you, to talk to a family member, to talk to someone in the community who's seen someone struggling on the street. The second piece is having someone to come, having a team of mental health professionals as an alternative to law enforcement to come. I don't think I need to tell this group that a quarter of the people shot and killed by police have a mental illness. And the vast majority of those people are also people of color, and the majority of them are Black men. And so really this, this development of this system is building off so much of the work of the civil rights movement and tying it in and finally bridging the mental health and civil rights pieces together, which is so exciting. And then of course, the third piece is somewhere to go. Right now, we do not have places for people to land and rest and recover. So when people are in crisis, they often end up in our emergency rooms where they can't access care, or in our jails where, needless to say, they can't access care. So we are working with six organizations as the lead sponsors, although we have a coalition of more than 100 that are in support. We are co-sponsoring along with the Miles Hall Foundation and a number of other organizations to champion this bill. It was an incredibly difficult political process last year. And it was the politics around very minute details that prevented the bill from passing last year. Everybody is on board with the top line vision, but when it boils down to it, what it came down to was money and power. We had the telecom corporations opposing the bill because we are going to fund the system with a 30-cent fee on your phone line every month. That's absurd. There's no reason that telecom companies shouldn't be willing to pay that money. While it is passed through to the consumer, companies like T-Mobile absorb the cost so that their customers don't have to pay those fees. That was incredibly frustrating. We also had different interest groups requiring or requesting more of that fee money than other parts of the system and for sole control over the system. Right now, we are in the second year of a two-year legislative cycle, which means even though AB 988 did not pass last year, it is still alive. We have until the end of this year to pass this version of the bill. Of course, if we're not successful this year, although I'm very confident we will be, we'll come again next year. We were an assembly bill, and so we made it over to the Senate at the end of last year, which puts us into a really luxurious position. It means that we don't have to move the bill until this summer. So we have, you know, the next 6 months to really negotiate this bill and see how much progress we can make. I will add that the bill is not the only way that we are advancing the work on 988. Because this number is going live in July 2022, it is turning on nationwide, whether the states take action to implement the system or not. California did set aside $20 million to start ramping up this system while we work on passing the bill. I'm also happy to share that the governor's budget proposal that came out in January included modest, but at least some ongoing funding for the 988-911 interoperability. And this is such a key piece of police diversion in the mental health system, because we know people are going to continue to call 911 And this will allow those calls to be transferred to 988 so that they can get appropriate care. So this is a really exciting piece. It's only one small piece of it, but it's a great first step. So we'll be continuing to advocate in the budget with the administration that is already getting this work underway, and of course with the bill. The primary way that you guys can get involved if you're interested is by supporting legislation and budget items via letters and showing up in committee and offering testimony in support of both. I'm happy to add you to our support list if you drop your email in the chat so you can stay up to date on when we're requesting letters for support, as well as when there will be hearing dates. I will stop talking because Taun has a lot more interesting things to say than me, but I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Tara. It's really, really helpful. Yeah, thank you very much. And I do want to like take a minute or a few minutes anyways to see if you have questions. And since we got you're on two pages, I think it would be helpful if you use the reaction bar to raise your hand, and then I'll be able to see you. Yeah, Jane, I see your hand.
Yeah. Hi, Sarah. Thanks for your great work. Tara, sorry. So I'm not sure I heard you right. Is that 988 number going to launch nationally? And what's the difference between that launching nationally and the California bill?
That's an excellent question. This is another example of politics getting in the way of good policy. So the way the federal government set up this system is unique. They are turning the 988 number on nationwide July 16th, 2022. It is up to each individual state to make sure that the call centers that already exist have the capacity to answer those calls, that we are setting up the mobile crisis team infrastructure so that we have alternatives to law enforcement, and to build and staff the facilities for people to land as alternatives to hospitals and jails. I will say that, you know, at least there's some legislation in Congress moving forward this year to provide some more support. But in the meantime, the number is going to go live, and folks will continue to have access to the counselors through the National Suicide Prevention Lifeline, but they will not have access to mobile crisis services at this time in California. And so really our charge is to kind of meet the moment and make sure that we're setting up this system so that Californians have the same access to services that people in other states do.
Thank you. And Linda Jimerson, you have a question.
Let's see. How did 988 do so well in the assembly? Were there big challenges there as well with this unit, this? Such a positive response from everybody, 100%. So what's the difference?
Yeah, you know, I think that there's broad support for what the bill does in both houses. Really, it came down to time and process. Negotiations were hot and heavy in July, and we weren't able to get a deal in time to meet the committee deadlines to move forward. And so we were able to, you know, pause the bill, keep it alive, and, you know, continue the policy discussion while taking this kind of initial first step of passing along this $20 million for ramping up call volume capacity. So at the very least, people can access a counselor and there aren't long waiting times or dropped calls or anything like that.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Linda. Any other last questions for Tara?
All right. Well, I saw some emails in the chat, so I'll make sure to take that down. And if there's anything at the end, happy to answer. Thanks so much for having me.
And
really.
We can also maybe talk, because we can put some of that information in our weekly communication to the White Anti-Racist group. So we're happy to do that.
Wonderful.
Yeah. Okay. And really, another person I'd really like to thank for actually bringing this to our attention is Linda Jimerson, who is a member of the WAG group, and she's the one who brought Taun and the Miles Hall Miles Hall and his story and this important legislation to our attention. So Linda, I'm gonna let you introduce Taun.
Okay, I will be so happy to do that. Thanks, David, and thanks, WAG. I'm so grateful to be able to introduce Taun today. A while back, I attended a Zoom meeting for people who are interested in volunteering for the Miles Hall Foundation. And Taun led the meeting and asked the question, what brought you here? And I was there for a few reasons, all of them pretty big for me. I was there because for many years, we've had a close African-American family member experience schizophrenic episodes. She lived in a mostly white community, and we met with the local police department, told them about her, that she wasn't dangerous. We gave them our phone numbers. It was always difficult, though, to get her to agree to get help when she was really sick. But she had a neighbor who was a friend and seemed to know exactly what to say to get her to agree to go to the hospital. That friend was our lifeline. But she wasn't professionally trained and she wasn't available 24/7. And when she was out of town, our family and our family member was ill, we had few options and the phone would eventually ring, calls from police departments or from Santa Rita jail. We were fortunate that we didn't lose our family member to a police intervention because there were so many. I was there because in 2011, a 15-year-old girl in my community rode her bike to her local high school. She attended two periods in the morning and then left school, got on her bike, and taking her bike and BART, she went to San Francisco and then to the Golden Gate Bridge, parked her bike properly in a bike rack, walked onto the bridge and never walked off. That's a long trip and a long time to think about things. Was there a point for her when even the tiniest bit of encouragement could have made a difference? I was there because the Trevor Project estimates that at least one LGBTQ youth between the ages of 13 and 24 attempts suicide every 45 seconds in the United States. And finally, I was there because in 2018 and then again in 2021, Andrew Hall, a Danville police officer, shot and killed two men of color who were both experiencing mental health issues. Their names were Latimer Arboleda in 2018 and Tyrell Wilson in 2021. In the latter case, Tyrell was homeless and shot in the face after 32 seconds of Andrew Hall speaking his first word. Had Tyrell looked like most other young Danville men, the outcome would have been different. Andrew Hall was charged with murder in the case of Latimer and found guilty of assault with a firearm. And Taun, we have not lost sight of the fact that justice for Miles is still outstanding. So much has occurred since Miles' murder on June 2nd, 2019. On June 2nd, exactly 2 years later, 2021, the California Assembly voted 70 yay, zero nay to pass the Miles Hall Lifeline Act. That amazes me, those voices in unison. It tells me how deeply each of us is affected by mental illness and its manifestations. I'll bet many tears were shed that day. Thank you, Taun, for being the mom that you are, for bringing Miles to life with your words and your actions, and for being willing to share your story and journey with us today.
Wow. Thank you. Thank you guys for having me here today. I remember Linda at that volunteer meeting in June of last year. And it's so important to have these conversations. That's why I speak so much. And I want people to understand like what happened to my son. So people like you can share their stories and we can grow as a group to make sure that we move in the right direction to create change. So I appreciate you sharing your personal stories because it is personal. Mental health is personal. But I also want to thank Tara as well. She's been a great advocate in the Steinberg Institute, always helping to speak and just really working super hard to move this bill forward. So I just, you know, I just want to make sure I thank her as well. And I just also am, this conversation Linda and I had, you know, when she said, oh, I would like you to speak at our anti-racist, at our white anti-racist group with Glide. I was so thrilled. But that was back in August. So, I mean, you guys are organized and it's obvious the way that you guys come together. And so thank you. And I appreciate the work you guys are doing and that you care and that social justice is important because we have together as a community and as people, we're strong together. And that's kind of what Miles' story is going to kind of tell, you know? So, and I just want to thank Pastor Marvin as well, you know, for his words, and just speaking about social justice and yeah. So like I said, I'm just really grateful to be in this space today. So I'm going to go ahead and kind of tell you about my son, my beautiful son, Miles. Unfortunately, he was, you know, shot and killed on June 2nd, 2019, while experiencing a mental health emergency. And we called for help. And if someone who's having a mental health crisis, we shouldn't have to call the police in order to get help. But that's the way that our system is set up right now. And instead of getting him help, he was criminalized. He should have been treated with compassion and care, but he was treated like a criminal. So having the trained mental health professionals, as Tara explained, is key because that could have saved Miles. And unfortunately, our call was answered with deadly bullets within 30 seconds of arrival. So similar to Tyrell on site, yelling his name, no de-escalation, and that should never be. But if we had 988, this federally mandated number, we had other options, but that's not here. So, you know, this phone number is so important to the safety of so many people. But a little bit about Miles, my beautiful son. He was the kind of person you would want to know. He was thoughtful, he was gentle, he was kind, he was compassionate. And he struggled with mental illness for years. But he was also a self-taught musician who made his own rap beats. He learned how to play the piano and the guitar. And he was adored by his family and his friends. He has a sister, Alexis, and they're best friends. They got along so well. I met my husband when I was at San Diego State. We both were there, fell in love, had Miles, started the American dream. I was in college when I had him, 23 myself when I had him, actually 22. And we moved to Walnut Creek when Miles was about 5, 3%. We moved to Walnut Creek, which is 3% African-American, very not very diverse. But we moved here for the safe community, the good schools. And as I say, we were living the American dream, had the kid, the picket fence. But as an elementary school kid, Miles was fidgety. He was diagnosed with ADHD. He had a difficult time concentrating. In middle school, he was liked by his peers, socially mature. And his friends would say that, you know, he was super inclusive and stood up for others. And he was really proud about that because he really did look out for the underdog. In high school, he played basketball as a freshman and he was on the honor roll. He was super proud about that. We were also super excited for him. And he actually got the most improved player that year. So that was really exciting for him. But things definitely dramatically started to change when he graduated from high school. And we realized that college wasn't for him. And we first thought, you know, he was being stubborn and that he was like failure to launch. But I kind of realized after that this was something different. It just felt different. I encouraged him to speak to a therapist. He didn't want to do that. And at one point this is where it started, is when he started to think he was Jesus and he started knocking on doors. And, you know, mind you, we live in Walnut Creek and it's not diverse, but Miles did grow up here and he was loved here. we had 26 neighbors right in this area, all knew Miles, and he was their child too. So I think people were very patient with him because they obviously could tell something was going on, but I was trying to get him help. I was like, something's not right here. I want to find out how I can help my son. I have a bachelor's degree in psychology. And I was like, this is something, maybe this is bipolar, maybe it's schizophrenia. I wasn't really sure. So I ended up taking a class, and I took it at NAMI, National Alliance of Mental Illness. And I learned some things there for sure. I learned that in order to get somebody help, they need to be a danger to self, danger to others, or gravely ill. So I realized that preventative help is almost impossible to get. It's very reactive. You have to have these certain criteria to get help, because Miles didn't understand he was sick in the first place. So I think with mental illness, people don't really understand unless you're in it or you have a family member, you don't get it. So that's one thing I think is super important for people to understand, is that his brain like doesn't realize that he's ill. So I took a 12-week family class with NAMI, and I learned more things about this, like mental health 101. And some of the things that they mentioned was making sure that law enforcement knew who Miles was. So I let law enforcement know that Miles, you know, was knocking on doors, and then they also were like, oh yes, we know, we've been getting calls about him. So I would say that when I made that first call to police, I thought, you know, we were building a relationship together. Like, if they knew that my Black son lives in this neighborhood, that they're gonna make sure he's cared for and with compassion and care. Right? I wasn't even thinking about, you know, the implicit bias. I just figured if they knew him, he's grown up here for 18 years, they're gonna take care of him. But unfortunately, that was not the case. I did find out that if Miles had three 5150s, a 5150 is a non-voluntary hospitalization. It's a police code that is used in California. But I learned that if he had three 5150s in 18 months, that we could potentially start a conservatorship process. So I was like, okay, this is one way that I can get Miles the help that he needs. And it's not, you know, hard to tell the story. I tell it all the time. And I always wish that this story would be different and it would end up different, but it's always the same outcome. Unfortunately, I feel like why can't I wake up from this dream? It's not, it's the reality. And that's why I work so hard to make sure that his story is told, because it's painful. sorry. So the day before that Miles was shot and killed, I had called the Walnut Creek mental health officer that now I had built a relationship with over for 2 years, to let her know that we might need help getting a 5150. She didn't answer. And I also called the non-emergency line. This is the day before Miles was shot. And I explained that Miles was having delusions and hallucinations. And the sergeant on duty said he would help. And he said he remembered Miles. We were able to get Miles help a year before with the help of the police. So I was confident that, you know, they knew who Miles was and they were going to take care of him and treat him with care and compassion. And mind you, Miles throughout this whole time is never, he's very gentle, very kind. So I was hopeful that they were going to help him. So, so the day that, on June 2nd is when Miles was in a full crisis, and he had broken a sliding glass door at our house with a garden tool that a neighbor gave him, because again, our neighbors are really close to us. They were seeing he was trying to dig up something and they were trying to help him out. Say, hey, Miles, use this. And he said that this garden tool was a staff from God. So at that moment, he broke the window. We had called 911 to get him help, right? To get care for him. And we explained when we called that Miles was having a mental health emergency and that we needed help and that he needed to be de-escalated. And he also needed to, that he also needed an ambulance. And the mental health officer from Walnut Creek called me back immediately. And she started asking questions like, what kind of things is Miles into? She was asking because she was gonna come on the scene and as I thought, help. But instead, four officers arrived on scene. Within 30 seconds, as I explained, Miles was shot four times. And unfortunately, he was killed. Sorry, my dog. One sec. My dog is talking to me. One sec, I get it.
It's a good moment, as we do with WAG, is to let that settle, let that land where it lands. The story, what moved you. Nothing you need to do about that, just notice.
Okay, sorry about that. So, as I said, Miles was shot four times, taken to the hospital, and when we got to the hospital, the officer was also there. She came and she was like, you know, your family did everything right. You guys are the model family for mental health. You guys really tried to do everything to help him, because as I said, there were so many roadblocks to get him help. And I knew at that moment, when actually he was pronounced dead, that this was my life's work. This is my life's work. I had to make sure this never happened to another family. Because as I explained, and it's hard to explain unless you're in it and you're doing it, how hard it is to get your loved one help when they have a mental illness and they don't understand they're sick. And it's reactive, very reactive. And that's why I know that this new bill, the Miles Howe Lifeline Act, AB 988, is really gonna make a difference. And it's really gonna change the course of so many people in so many generations. And I'm, you know, my son Miles is part of this movement, and unfortunately his death has brought us here. So as I explained, I had to make sure that this didn't happen in another family. So my friends and family, neighbors, people I don't know, like Linda, you know, just started to organize. And we started going to city council, packing the house, demanding answers, and making sure we also created a group called Friends of Scott, Alexis, and Taun Hall. And that stands for, well, Friends of Alexis, Scott Hall. So that's a community organization. We had a Facebook group that grew up to 500 people. And we also had the help with Gigi Crowder from NAMI Contra Costa. But we weren't being quiet, and we were holding the city accountable. We were attending the city councils twice a month for over a year and a half. And they treated us like troublemakers. They treated us like we were the ones who were the problems. But the system is a problem. The system has failed our family and has failed so many others, like we see from that video we saw, say their names. Unfortunately, although so many of those names now, I am in a family, I'm in a group that I know a lot of these parents now. Like how is this even possible, you know? So, you know, Wanda Johnson, I've learned a lot from her, her brother Cephas Johnson. And one thing they said was, hold these institutions accountable and make sure that we contact legislators and we are not quiet. And exactly what we did. So we met Rebecca Bauer Kane, our assemblywoman from Orinda. She was doing a walk. She, you know, told everybody what she was doing, and a lot of people came to sit walk with her, and we talked her ear off for probably half a mile and told her about miles. And then probably, I don't know, 3 months later, she reached out to us and she explained about this new bill that was federally mandated. We asked her if we could partner with her and to make sure that this was the bill was also named after Miles. Because of the advocacy, we're here. And as Tara so eloquently explained how great this bill will and how this bill could have saved Miles is what really drives us. We also formed alliances with other groups in the county, and we were able to push the Board of Supervisors in Contra Costa County to create a non-police response program in Contra Costa, where Miles was killed. And the pilot program is actually now functioning. It's not 100%, but they do have a part of this hub. They call it the Miles Hall Crisis Hub, which is also named after Miles. And it's my hope that every county and every state will have something like this. We also created the Miles Hall Foundation in my son's name. We are a 501c3, so we are a nonprofit. And our main focus is prevention, advocacy, and education. So education to be here to speak to you guys, right? To make sure people understand what happened to Miles, why this should never happen again, and how we can work to make sure this doesn't happen again. And it's people like you, like Tara, who are fighting to make sure that we can create change. But our mission of the Miles Hall Foundation is to educate communities about mental illness and support those most impacted by mental illness by excessive use of force by law enforcement. So that is our real goal, because we do not want to make sure this happens to another family. Because police cannot be the main resources when they're not even trained to handle situations, right? So they have 10 hours of training, and these social workers that, like Tara explained, that could be on the other line to call when you call, they have thousands of hours. So there's just a lot of work we have to do with that. But out of our tragedy, we are creating change, we're creating hope, and making sure that another Miles Hall doesn't happen where he's shot and killed behind his home in broad daylight within 30 seconds. And that's where the implicit bias comes in, right? Because we're seeing all over the nation, white kids going and shooting up places and they still come out alive. And then Miles has a garden tool. Just keep that in mind. And he's shot 4 times. So I just, you know, this fail first system for one has to change. And I'm really grateful for you guys, again, giving me the opportunity to talk about my son. He's beautiful. And you guys will see that in a couple seconds, because we're gonna play a video and get to know our family a little bit better. So if you could play the video, I'd appreciate it. Thank you.
Mother, mother, there's too many of you crying. Brother, 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 there's far too many of you dying.
you know, we've got to find a way to bring some love in here today. Father, Father, we don't need to escalate. Oh, you see, war is not the answer, for only love can conquer hate. You know we've got to find a way to bring some love in here today. Oh, picket lines and picket signs, don't punish me with brutality. Come on, talk to me so you can see. Oh, what's going on? What's going on? Oh, what's going on? Yeah, what's going on? Everybody thinks we're wrong. Oh, but who are they to judge us simply 'cause our hair is long? You know we've got to find a way to bring some understanding here today. Oh, picket lines and picket signs, don't punish me with brutality. Come on, talk to me so you can say, oh, what's going on? What's going on? Oh, what's going on? Tell you what's going on.
With us, and we feel like we have your attention, but here it is with the leadership. Now we have to, when we come with you guys at models that are working at other states, we really want you guys to really listen to them, embrace them, and make it happen here in Walnut Creek, because Miles represents unfortunately America. He really does, except he's an African-American male with a mental illness, so then he represents somehow death. And this is how our life is now without him. So there's a lot of firsts here. Now we have our first Thanksgiving without Miles. And I want you to think about how you guys are going to feel with us not having him this year. I'm sure this is not your fault, but you guys now have a responsibility to make change here in Walnut Creek. So when we come up with Cahoot's model, Wisconsin's model, whatever model, please make sure that you guys listen and really take it to heart, because this is our son, and he's your community, and he's bright, and he's vibrant, and he's beautiful, and he's mine. Thank you.
What's going on?
Thank you all for your time. And I don't know if anyone had any questions for me, but I'm happy to answer questions. I know it's a lot. It's a lot to take in. He's a beautiful child, you know, he's a beautiful child, and he was a beautiful person, and he should have never been in this position to be criminalized. And that's what we need or the work we're doing to remove police from mental health calls.
Thank you, Taun. Maybe we'll just take a minute or so just to have some silence, to again practice holding this space and holding the ways in which our hearts might have been moved to action or moved in some other kind of way. So just a minute of silence, and then we'll take some questions. Thank you, everyone. So deep bow to you, Taun. Thank you for your courage and your heart and just your testimony, really, of this just incredible gift of turning something so tragic into something that the world needs. So I don't know how that happens, but you're doing it. And so thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks so much.
So if you're up for it, we'll maybe take a few questions.
Yeah.
And I see, is it?
Oh, I see one from Edie Nelson.
Yeah.
That's my mother.
Oh, fabulous.
So let's see what Edie has to say. Hi, Mom. We can't hear you, though. You're muted.
Okay, now I'm muted? Okay. So this isn't a question. It's just a statement. That when Taun says that she immediately knew this was her life work, she literally walked out of the hospital and said to me, "This is my life's work. I want to make sure that no other family ever has to go through this." And that is incredible in terms of, I don't think that I could have handled it this way, but she has, she did. And she was surrounded with incredible friends from Walnut Creek and all over who have really supported her and the mission that she's on. And again, it's to understand that when someone is an adult and they don't recognize that they have a mental illness, right now, we are really in a quandary as to how to handle that. And that's part of what the Miles Hall Foundation is really working at, is to find ways so that people can get care, even if they don't recognize that they need it. And during this time, I just want to let you know that on a highway close to Nashville, Tennessee, someone was sitting on a guardrail and he was stopped. I mean, they came up to him, but he was just killed by nine policemen. He did not have a weapon. And so I think that we understand that this is not just something locally. This is something that is happening in our country, and that it is just so important that we recognize this and stop it. And that's all I have to say. Except I really, really loved Miles, and he was such a blessing to us while he was here.
Glad you were able to come on.
And I'll bet Taun is an apple that didn't fall far from the tree.
You can tell, huh?
Yes.
A great mama. Okay, put your hand down now.
Oh, okay. I'm working on it.
I got you. Oh, there it is. Okay. Hi, Beth. Looks like you have a question. Thanks for being on today.
So much. Thank you for sharing it with us. And I'm so sorry for your loss, too. I have a two-parter, if that's all right.
Sure.
First is, what's the most meaningful and constructive support that you like to receive in this? And then the other part is, I'm curious, as you've interacted with police officers, what are the types of resistance or any kind of defensiveness? Is there a theme that you hear over and over that we can help know that and share the message as we have conversations with people too?
Yeah, well, thank you for asking those questions. You know, as far as things that I need, as far as going through this journey that, you know, you never expect you're going to be in, like a club you don't ever think you're going to be part of. For me, it is really just advocacy. For me, it's just really important. Like, I've even like went to some therapy and it just wasn't really what I needed to do. So I think for me, it's just really talking about Miles and decriminalizing him. Because whenever you think of someone being shot by like police, I think it's just, you automatically go to, oh, well, you know, he had a garden tool. Like, he had a garden tool, but he should have never, he wasn't brandishing it towards anybody. So that's, you know, so that's, and I also would recommend that you guys all go to it's on here, justiceformileshall.org. The video is on there. Some people, you know, want to see it. Because it tells more of the story again of the overreaction, the compulsivity of the police, and they were also not trained. One person was on for 1 year on the force, and the other was another like 2 years. And then also to answer your second part question about what kind of resistance am I getting from the police, you know, surprisingly, I'm not getting a lot of resistance when it comes to them understanding that they don't need to show up to mental health calls. So I think they're like the catch-all for everything. They're doing it all and they know that they shouldn't be doing it all. So I think that's encouraging, is that we're not getting pushback. Like, they want to do it. They don't want to do it either. So I think that's also helping the momentum of removing police out of the work, out of mental health calls. But it is definitely triggering for me to be around police. So it wasn't like that before. It definitely is like that now. Sirens, you know, so all those things that I like, it's PTSD. And it's crazy how you don't think it affects you, but it I mean, you know, it affects you, but so I don't know if that answers your question, but I would just say to, you know, with police that, I mean, I don't have a problem with police. Yeah. Thank we you. Need police for criminals. Yeah, not mental health. Yeah. Hey, Pastor Marvin. How you doing?
Hey, how you doing?
Good.
What, your son was beautiful.
Thank you.
And reminds me of all the boys I grew up with. Who on any wild and out night could have been mistaken for anything.
Mm-hmm.
I'm curious about your work with other Black folks and families of color. Mm-hmm. And are there any barriers to us participating in this kind of work, calling a number? Do we typically not call because, you know, we keep stuff in our families? Mm-hmm. You know, what have you found working with families of color, and what have you found has worked to bring them into this advocacy work?
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely a challenge, right? Black people don't want to call the police. Mm-hmm. Right? Especially if you live in certain communities. And like, I've always lived in, I haven't lived in communities of color. Like, you saw my mom's white, but I have a Black family, you know? So I think different people have different relationships with the police.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And I think it's going to be, that will be part of the work that I'd like to see the foundation do, is bringing people of color along to realize that you can call this number. You can call 988. and that, you know, because I think it's still tied to the state, right? And potential violence that could happen to your loved one. But I would say there's definitely resistance, you know, and also as I tell my story, and people just don't get it, like, especially Black people, they don't necessarily understand, like, what, why would you call the police? Like, yeah. But they don't understand our story, because the barriers are trying to get him help. And that's why we created that relationship with the police. So they knew him. Yeah. So I was like, oh, cause Miles would go to other cities and visit my mother-in-law. And I was afraid that the police didn't know him there. Mm-hmm. So like he was at a disadvantage, but he was truly at a disadvantage anywhere he went, even with the relationship that you build.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know. Does that answer your question?
Yeah. That's great. Okay.
Yeah. Time. It's going to be a lot of work.
I am.
Yeah.
To make that find shift. Out more.
Yeah. Yeah, to make
how the we shift. Can help.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you for your support. Hi, Linda.
Hi, Taun. Are there areas that need the most pressure, individuals or regions, or, you know, in terms of advocating for Senate passage, any place to really focus?
I think, you know, as long as you get on with Tara, and yes. then she can kind of direct where the needs will be, because she's on it. Like, in fact, that's why she had to jump off. Excuse me, because she was about to go to another call to strategize on, you know, more of the bill. But yeah, I think, and on our website, on justiceformileshall.org, we do have an AB 988 section that is also keeping people up to date. There's a petition that you guys can sign. I would recommend doing that. You know, it's just, it's, the more people know about it and talk about it, it's, you know, it's going to help the work that we're doing. Yeah. Did anyone else have any other questions? Because I have a few other things I couldn't share as well, some of the work that we are doing. And maybe something will come up with somebody and they'll have another question. Right now, also part of the work that the foundation is really interested and is doing is working in schools. So having those anti-racist dialogues, having the social justice dialogues, making sure that we are inclusive, that those kids are inclusive, and we're talking about mental health. Because, you know, as Linda explained, her neighbor, I remember that story. I remember that girl. Like, I remember hearing, they didn't know where she went. Her bike was at the bridge. Like, no way, she didn't kill herself. I remember that. That was 10 years ago. So it's so important not just to talk about mental illness and suicide, but also if you're feeling some kind of way, and maybe you're already starting to have signs of schizophrenia or bipolar and things that people really don't talk about that much at school. You know, they really don't talk about in-depth mental illness like that. But just getting those conversations started. So I'm actually doing some work with Mount Diablo Education School District here in Concord. And so I'm really happy that their district is welcoming some of the work we're doing. Yeah. But as I mentioned, we are a 501c3. So, you know, we are tax deductible donations as well. So, yeah. Oh, it looks like David has a question.
Yeah, thanks, Taun. So I was really, I work in mental health, and I was really moved by what Tara said is someplace to call, someone to come, and somewhere to go.
Yeah.
And so I'm curious about that last one, somewhere to go. Mm-hmm. Is this in the line of conservatorship, like you were hoping with Miles, or is it what's the yeah. go? What's the place?
Yeah. So the place to go is going to be like a respite.
Oh, okay.
So after they get out of the hospital, they're not ready to necessarily come home. But right now they have nowhere to go. So they come home and then they come home and probably they're not well, and they're going to have another reoccurring problem right away. So some people get hospitalized over and over, or there's more police interaction there doesn't need to be because of that respite care. So if that respite care is there, then it's going to help that person long term. Yeah.
Great. Yeah. Thank you.
That helps. Yeah, no, it's a great question. Hi, Rachel.
Hi, Taun. I'm Rachel. Thank you so much for being here with us tonight and for sharing your story of your beautiful son.
Yeah,
thank you. I just had a question about what age group for the schools, because I work in the school system like K through second grade. I'm just curious to know what age group you work with.
Yeah, so right now we're targeting middle schoolers. Okay. So that's kind of, you know, that's a tough age, tough group. So I figured at that age group, we can have those, maybe start with some of those conversations that they're trying to find their own identity. And then maybe if we do some of this more talking, just talking about like maybe what's going on and not being like a counselor, but just having difficult conversations and like doing the kind of work that you guys are doing and with WAG, right, is being anti-racist. And there's so much like implicit bias too, right? Talking that, bringing that into the school. So it's because obviously there is a, we have a systemic problem, right? And that's where I think with working with children, if we start young, hopefully make a difference. Yeah, thanks for asking. Okay. Hi, Pamela. Did you have any other questions, Rachel? That was it. Okay. Pamela, sorry. Oh, you're muted. You're muted, Pamela. Okay.
I was just thinking about the overlap of this whole domain of mental health and drug addiction. And it's like a Venn diagram, because there is that overlap between the two, and yet separateness still. Mm-hmm. So I'm wondering how that comes into your work, and if it's an issue of drug addiction, is it still 988?
Yes. So a lot of the chemical dependency and mental illness, they go hand in hand, and homelessness, right? All those things. So as far as 988, it's really, really for like crisis. It's really for like someone in a crisis situation, someone who needs help with maybe they're contemplating suicide, or that's what it was, a suicide prevention line before. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I mean, they could call that number and still get resources though, right? If they're having a drug addiction or they want help, there would be resources that social worker could give them about different things that they maybe programs that they could get involved in. So it really is going to help, because you have that trained person, right, who understands, right, and understands probably what that person is going through, who has chemical dependency as well.
Thank you.
Yeah. So it seems like that might be all the questions. So yeah. But thank you all for the time. Linda, thank you again for setting this up like back in August. You and David, I tell you, I was like, these people are really on top of things. All the way in January. I was like, okay, I got it on my calendar. So, but thank you. It was a great, you know, you guys did a great job and you guys have a great group. So thank you again for your time and letting me share Miles with you guys. As you can tell, he's a very, very special person. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Taun.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you for sharing such a beautiful story. And I'm so sorry for your loss.
Thank you so much. Yeah, it's painful. It's hard.
No doubt.
Yeah.
So Fiona?
Yeah, hey everyone. So I feel very humbled to be asked to close this out. And I really kind of sat with your story, Taun, and Miles's story, and then, you know, what we've been trying to do as a group. And first of all, I just want to really thank you for coming here and speaking with us and, you know, giving of your energy to us and doing that labor. You shouldn't have to do that. No one should have to do that work. I stand in solidarity with you. I think I can speak for our group that we do, and if there's anything I can personally do, you know, I'm going to sign all the petitions and spread the word for sure. So I chose a poem. It's just a very short poem. It's not as poetic as some of the amazing poets we have at Glide, but I felt like it, I was thinking about when a young person's life is taken. I was thinking about that. I was thinking about you and how you've, you know, stepped into this amazing role. And then also for all of us that have some, you know, have this inner work to do, facing racism and also activism to do in the world. So it's a poem from Rumi. You were born with potential. You were born with goodness and trust. You were born with ideals and dreams. You were born with greatness. You were born with wings. You are not meant for crawling, so don't. You have wings. Learn to use them and fly. Thank you.
Yeah.
Beautiful, Fiona. Thank you. We'll take that as our blessing as we get ready to leave. So if you want to unmute your microphones, maybe you can wish each other a good night. And just a reminder that we meet, we're an ongoing group, and we'd love to have other white allies join us. So there's an open invitation. So.
And that's not last name.
What?
That's not last name.
Your last name is.
I got you.
Yes. You're way too fast for me, Marvin.
He's a goodie. But I would like to just, before we leave, when we're ready to leave, I just want to say, we always say at the end, when I have a presentation, I always like to say Miles' name. So say his name, Miles Hall.
Miles Hall.
Name. Yeah. Thank you, right? Because that is a powerful video.
Anyway.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Is Taun still with us? Taun?
Taun Butler's there, yes.
Oh, I thought we could just go out on that same music. No one needs to stay for it. Just, you know, in the as background. Winnie. Would you rather not?
No. That's okay. Good. I'm just waving goodbye as people start to go. We're meeting next week. Next week's our next one. I hope to see many of you there. Have a great week, everybody.
Take care, everyone. Thanks for coming. Taun.
Thanks for Miles Hall.
Thank you, Taun.
Taun. Thanks, everybody.
Bye. Bye-bye. Thank you.
Bye, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Bye, everybody.
Say the name,
from love that we're alive.
Say the name,
if we
but eating Negro, know your place. Stop and frisk, fill up that cage. Lock your bodies full of rage.
Say their name.
Say their names.
Tamir Rice, Alex and Yeto.
Say their names.